Thank you to the Society of Composers Incorporated for the invitation to speak at this conference. My name is John Dante Prevedini, and this presentation is Augenmusik as an Audience Building Tool. First of all, what is Augenmusik? The term is a German word which literally translates into English as eye music or music for the eyes, and it basically means notated music that also serves as visual art. It has a long history as a fringe compositional genre with roots dating back to the Middle Ages. But in recent years, it's found a surprising new life in the fast visual culture of social media. So a good part of this presentation is going to be about why Augenmusik might be suddenly undergoing this shift, and thus what it means for composers today as a potential audience-building tool. Augenmusik can present itself in potentially endless ways, but I propose there are two basic types that we can observe in the existing repertoire. The first of these is structural Augenmusik, which means that the visual elements in the notation are related to the music's sonic structure. The second of these is decorative Augenmusik, which means that the visual elements in the notation are not related to the sonic structure of the music. Now, this is not to say that decorative Augenmusik cannot be symbolically impactful or artistically significant to the presentation of the piece. It just means that in decorative Augenmusik, the visual elements in the score exist independently from any audible implications on the resulting notated performance. We can also have hybrid forms of Augenmusik that combine both structural and decorative elements. And lastly, all of these can potentially exist in combination with aspects of traditional notation systems that remain unaffected. Here are a few examples of Augenmusik from the past to the present. This first image is one of the earliest known examples we have, and it's from the late 14th century French composer Baud Cordier. This I would categorize as decorative Augenmusik, since the heart shape effect is achieved by reshaping the musical staves themselves into a heart. If we were to stretch the staves back out into straight lines, the resulting composition would look and sound much like most regular music of the period. So the heart shape is not fundamentally tied to the sonic structure. Next is an 18th century example from the Gulliver Suite by Telemann. As you can probably guess, it's a programmatic suite inspired by Gulliver's travels, which was first published within Telemann's lifetime. Specifically, this shows two movements from the work. The first one we see is Telemann's interpretation of the Lilliputians, a society of tiny people who are all about 6 inches tall. The second one is his interpretation of the Brobdingnagians, a society of gigantic people who are all about 70 feet tall. Respectively, Telemann characterizes these societies in the music using ludicrously small and ludicrously large rhythmic note values. So this I would categorize as structural Augenmusik, since the effect really does relate to the implied sonic structure of the music. Now we have an example from the 20th century. This is from the Macrocosmos by the recently deceased George Crumb, and it's a setting of the Agnus Dei for solo voice and piano, clearly in the shape of a peace sign. This I would consider decorative Augenmusik, for reasons similar to what we saw with the Baud Cordier example earlier. Specifically, the peace sign is made from shaping the musical staves themselves, not the audible music actually notated on those staves. And lastly, here's an example that I composed in the spring of 2020 as an experiment during the COVID lockdown. This is Selfie, and it's literally a transcription of my face into piano music. I intentionally composed this as structural Augenmusik, since there's a one-to-one correspondence between visual contours of the image and audible contours of the pitch-based content in the music. I'll have more to say about this piece later on in the presentation. But for now, I'll leave you with this brief excerpt from the beginning of the piece to illustrate how it sounds. As we can see, a major question in the composition of Augenmusik is how to reconcile the visual and auditory dimensions in the notation. Should we use structural Augenmusik? Should we use decorative Augenmusik? Should there be phenomenological synergy between the significance of the image and the significance of the music we hear? Or perhaps the image and sound should intentionally clash with each other? How does the symbolism of the piece's title fit into it all? Moving on, how do questions of performance or performability fit in? Visually impactful Augenmusik often involves making music notation systems do things they weren't designed to do. And so composers of Augenmusik might have to consider a lot of factors in terms of keeping the score practical and usable as a score. Rhythm, musical form, instrumentation, dynamics, and accidentals are just some of the potential factors here. Lastly, here, composers may decide to turn to non-traditional notation practices to solve these problems. Here's an example of a piece in which the relationships among image, sound, and title are synergistically conceived. The image is a transcription of the face of Abigail Adams after a portrait by Gilbert Stuart. The title is from a quote out of a letter she wrote to her son John Quincy, in which she says, quote, "The habits of a vigorous mind are formed in contending with difficulties," unquote. Here's a short excerpt from the beginning of the piece. Next, here's an example of audiovisual reconciliation using color. This is a transcription of a landscape photo in which visual color is transformed into orchestral timbre. Also, as with the previous piece, you'll notice it has a non-standard key signature in the Bartok tradition. This is a way of introducing harmonic variety into Augenmusik without having to break up the visual image horizontally with accidentals in the notation. In both pieces, I use non-standard key signatures to indicate a scale that repeats at the perfect fifth instead of the octave. Here's a brief example of the Ipswich Landscape Symphony from the beginning of the third system in the score. So why does Augenmusik matter today? While Augenmusik has traditionally been something of an occasional novelty for composers, nowadays it appears regularly in the fast visual culture of both social media and traditional media. Part of this, I postulate, is due to the economics of attention. Think of it this way. Nowadays we're constantly being inundated with information, and our attention is therefore in limited supply and in high demand. Imagine you're scrolling through your social media feed and you see two posts, both by content creators who are unfamiliar to you. The first is an inaudible link to an audio demo that takes 4 minutes to hear of a composer you know nothing about. The second is a thumbnail of a visibly beautiful photo of a sunset at the beach that takes 10 seconds to notice by a photographer you know nothing about. Which would you be more likely to click on, knowing nothing else? The photo that takes 10 seconds to see, or the audio link that takes 4 minutes to hear? That's precisely the question that composers of new music must face when they have to rely on social media to grow their audiences. For this reason, I sometimes say that a picture is worth a thousand notes. And I maintain Augenmusik thrives in contemporary media partly for this reason. Another aspect of this is that Augenmusik communicates directly with audiences. This is very significant. The score itself can be the audience's introduction to the piece, even if a performance is impossible. This is exactly the situation we're just coming out of post-lockdown, so it's something I think we should all bear in mind. It also represents a dramatic departure from the typical history of Augenmusik. Up until this point, Augenmusik was usually something of an inside joke between composer and performer, as the audience would almost never see the score. But today, an Augenmusik score can be shared online and reach literally millions of people within seconds, potentially communicating something about the music to them in an instant without a single note having been heard. And that's especially true for structural Augenmusik. Moving on, Augenmusik can engage multiple learning styles when presenting compositional content and subject matter. So this is valuable for teachers as a potential audience as well. Not just music teachers, but also in other subjects like science, social studies, or world languages. When we share our content on social media as composers, most of us probably tend to do one of three things. We might link to a performance video of our music, or perhaps a scrolling score demo, or maybe a simple audio demo with background art or a screenshot of our workstation. Those are all, at least, the sorts of formats I tend to see other composers using, and which I've always used myself when posting traditionally formatted music content. But in 2020, when concert venues were all closed due to the lockdown, I decided to try an experiment, reinventing my own approach to composition, to focus on single-page scores that could quickly communicate the gist of the musical idea visually on social media, including Augenmusik. The next slide shows the numerical data of how this experiment played out, using both traditionally formatted music posts and single-page visual music posts on my Facebook page. As you can see, Facebook's calculation of the engagement rate was nearly double, on average, for the single-page visual scores compared with traditionally formatted music-related posts on my page. Now, double may not seem like an overwhelming difference, but remember that when engagement includes shares or reposting, these effects become compounding. So the ultimate impact of the visual element on user reach can become exponential instead of just linear. And in fact, that's exactly what I saw with my content. And a consequence of this can be seen on the next slide. Here are three examples of Classic FM's coverage of Augenmusik from August 2020 to July 2021. As you can see, the first article is about my experimental selfie composition, and then others followed. The next is from TikTok composer Luke Spine, who transcribes people's names and home state maps into music. His approach is interesting because he uses piano roll notation to achieve Augenmusik, not staff notation. So it's a purely structural approach based on direct visual mapping of pitch and time only. The last article is about composer Noam Oxman, who transcribes custom animal portraits into sheet music, using a hybrid approach. The note heads provide structural Augenmusik, while the note stems and beams provide decorative Augenmusik to enhance the visible image. Here's another piece by Noam Oxman. This one's part of an awareness campaign on animal welfare and bullfighting, and it's a good example of how Augenmusik can be used by composers as a tool for social activism as well. Next, this is an example from a very recent article from interlude.hk, featuring six works of Augenmusik from over the centuries, which shows us that even very old Augenmusik has an appeal in today's visual culture. And now we have an example of a Pinterest page on the topic, which has received 410 contributions within just 2 years. So this all goes to show that Augenmusik is a genre that clearly has generated some surprising attention in recent years, especially considering its rather obscure history before this. So, in conclusion, why is Augenmusik a valuable audience-building tool? For one thing, it has demonstrable appeal in today's fast visual culture. Next, if done strategically, the visual element can attract new audiences, quote-unquote, by itself, without needing a sonic performance. Furthermore, it has educational utility by presenting subject matter through multiple learning formats simultaneously. And lastly, it has social and commercial outreach potential beyond typical new music circles, which includes the visual art market and social activism, among others. So I encourage you all to consider the potential of Augenmusik as a tool for building new audiences. It's something I think deserves to be taken seriously by the Academy and conservatories as a genre with potential for both artistic expression and community outreach. And I invite you all to experiment with it for yourselves. Thank you all for attending today, and I wish you well in your compositional adventures.